He was a massive figure in the world of theoretical physics, and many people won't have heard of him, and yet I think it'd be fair to say that his work led to the probably three Nobel Prizes being awarded.
Not to him though?
Not to him, and he could have been involved in certainly at least two of them, I think. He could have if things had turned out differently. He was actually born in 1932 in India, in Madras, to I think British parents who were working over in India. He came back to Scotland to be educated at college in Scotland, and he spent his undergraduate and postgraduate time at Edinburgh University. And then I think he went over to Caltech for a period, for a year, before securing a position at Imperial College and back in the late 50s at Imperial, and he stayed there till he died. So I knew him through his work on cosmology, and then that required a knowledge of particle physics, and that in turn requires a detailed knowledge of quantum field theory. Tom was a pioneer of that field. The work that he developed, the techniques he developed, have applications not only in particle physics, cosmology, but also in condensed matter physics. And so he was able to develop an area of physics which is sort of the interface between condensed matter and cosmology, as well as his pioneering work involving the Higgs particle, early universe, phase transitions, symmetry breaking, gravity. There was one thing I discovered. He worked in 1961, he wrote a paper in which he looked at a modification of general relativity. I thought recently that I've been seeing references to this paper of Tom's, 1961. And I just looked back, in 2015, it had over 100 citations, this paper he wrote. You know, that's the kind of impact he had across the fields. He was able to write things, and then it lay dormant for a while, and then people realised, wow, this is really impressive stuff. The first and the one that our 60 Symbols viewers will know most about is probably the Higgs, right? The discovery of the Higgs back in 2012, I think, which led to the Nobel Prize in 2013. The mechanism, which is known as the Higgs mechanism, was developed independently by three groups. One of those groups involved Tom. He wrote a paper that was published in Physical Review Letters, and that has become one of their flagship papers that they often cite as being one of their key contributions to the journal. He wrote it with his friends Guralnik and Hagen, and because of this crazy law rule that we've discussed, that the Nobel Prize can only go to three people, they decided, I guess, they couldn't just give it to Tom and not give it to the other two. They were giving it to Higgs and Ongler, quite rightly. So Tom missed out. Tom wrote a second, probably even more influential paper. He actually was the person that demonstrated how you can use this mechanism in the proper world of particle physics. We knew that one of the key particles in nature is the W and Z vector boson. These tell us about how the weak interactions behave. These are very massive particles. We didn't know how to give these masses, and Tom is the person that actually demonstrated how you do this. He came up with the actual mathematical formalism to introduce masses to these particles. This then, in 1967, he wrote this paper, so 3 years after the Higgs mechanism. He applied it to this realistic situation, provided the breakthrough that helped Weinberg understand the standard model of particle physics, and Salam. So Weinberg and Salam shared the Nobel Prize with Glashow for the standard model of particle physics. It also had a knock-on effect that the formalism that Tom had developed in this 1967 paper, the very mathematical formalism, helped to Hooft and Veltman understand that this model, standard model, was what they call renormalizable. This means that you can make actual predictions with the model, basically. But the formalism that Tom had developed helped them. They then got the Nobel Prize as well. And of course, you also have the fact that Tom independently discovered the Higgs mechanism in 1964, which got the Nobel Prize for Higgs and Ongler. So three Nobel Prizes came out of work directly related to Tom. I found it kind of the most humbling experience I think I've seen that day when the Nobel Prize was announced. First of all, there was a delay. You might recall there was a delay of over an hour, and it turned out the delay was they were trying to find Higgs, but to let him know. But people were thinking, well, maybe they've told Tom and Tom has turned it down, because he would have known that if he got it, his two collaborators wouldn't have got it. That wasn't the case. But I have read since Tom told his son, Robert, that he was actually quite relieved not to have got the prize, because if he had have got the prize, it would have been at the expense of his close friends and collaborators of the original paper.
Well, that's what Tom thought, so I guess you have to go with his wishes. But what do you think about the fact he never got a Nobel Prize? I mean, he did win a lot of prizes.
He did win a lot of prizes. He is recognised as being a giant in this field. I think it's sad that they didn't get it, but I fully appreciate his attitude and his, I believe it, you know. The day of when the prizes were announced, he was being interviewed all over the place, and you didn't hear a single word of bitterness or criticism. The closest I got where it was, he said, well, if they have these archaic rules for the award of the Nobel Prize, he can't get it. But I knew him quite well. He was a good friend and collaborator, and he never, ever complained or said anything derogatory about the award of the prize. Never.
What do you think he was bringing to the table that made him so exceptional? What was his sort of unique selling point or his skill?
What
was Tom's thing?
Oh, okay. So I was actually thinking about this today, funnily enough, coming in. I think mathematically incredibly strong. He knew detailed mathematics about areas known as group theory and homotopy theory. These played essential roles. For example, his understanding of group theories and non-abelian gauge theories allowed him to understand how this vector boson could acquire a mass for the W whilst the photon remained massless. It was Tom that realized this. And so he brought this very detailed mathematical knowledge of quantum mechanics, quantum field theory, group theory, homotopy theory to the table, coupled with this deep understanding of the physical side. When I worked with him, he would always be asking about the physical consequences of a calculation. You know, does it make sense physically? We're dealing with objects that are meant to be in the universe. Does it make sense? Can we already rule it out? And so he was a physicist, but with a very strong mathematical bent. And that, I think, was this unique thing that other people have it, but he had it in this particular combination, which was just right. He was kind, he was gentle, he was never afraid to tell you if he thought you were wrong. He was determined to get things as accurately as possible. The number, you know, I worked with him on quite a few papers, I was privileged to do that, and the number of iterations of papers where we would be discussing words, you know, the level of words, are we saying this right, and the calculations we would check, double check. He was really rigorous in his approach, but he had time for everyone. There are so many stories of Tom being sort of people banging on his door when he was head of department at Imperial and coming in almost off the street, some people, to tell him their ideas, and he would listen. And he would listen to them, and then he'd probably say, I don't know, rather than dismiss things. But he would always listen. He always had time. Young scientists, like when I arrived at Imperial as a 24-year-old, 25-year-old, he had so much time for people and to listen and offer them advice. There is a little story that might be worth telling you about. I got invited to give a seminar at Imperial. They were considering hiring me for a postdoc. I was at Newcastle doing a PhD, and it wasn't in the area Tom worked. So I worked really hard on my presentation. It was the time of transparencies. I made it way too technical, as new people, new fresh PhD students do, because I was trying to impress. So I went down and gave this talk, and it blew everyone away because it was just too technical, apart from the few experts who already knew it. So it wasn't great. And then after the talk, Tom went off. He didn't ask any questions. He went off to his room because he was head of department. And my friend Ray Rivers said, well, you should go meet Tom. You know, he's a famous guy, and you might be here as a postdoc. So I went to his office and sat down in his office. And he was at his table, and he smiled, and he didn't say anything. Nothing. And I'm thinking, oh, okay. And what felt like minutes went by, and eventually I said, well, it's me who's come to see him. I should say something. So I said, well, Professor Kibble, I know you're a very important person. I really respect your work and would like to know, what did you think? Have you got any advice for me? I'm just starting. And he looked and he went, don't write in yellow. So all my transparencies, all my equations I'd written in yellow, none of them had projected onto the board. So every single equation nobody could see. Not only was it a really technical talk, nobody could see an equation. And that was his bit of advice. And then we chatted a bit more, and in fact we began a collaboration a couple of years later when I returned to the UK, and well, we had a fantastic time. But he was just, he, rather than saying your talk was just rubbish, he just, don't write in yellow.
Did you ever bring that up with him, like years later? Did you say, do you remember saying that?
I did. He just smiled, as he would. Tom wasn't afraid of silence. He didn't feel the need. He would never try and dominate. He hated being the centre of attention. He just didn't want it. But he would always be prepared to tell you, you know, give his thoughts on something if you wanted to know. But so you could go for tea with Tom and not say anything, it'd be fine. And initially it's a bit, felt a bit awkward, but then you realise, oh no, it's fine. And then you just say something and he'd reply, and it was all great. You can't, how do you then give it to three more? Once I realised that he hadn't got it, I just texted him and said, I'm very sorry to hear you didn't get it. I think you deserved it. And he replied. He replied almost immediately. And he just said, thanks very much. He's such a modest guy. He didn't say, I know, that's people.